word, good citizen. You would proceed especially against Caius Martius?
Against him first. He's a very dog to the commonality.
Consider you what services he has done for his country.
Very well, and could be content to give him good report for it, but that he pays himself with being proud.
Nay, but speak not maliciously.
I say unto you, what he hath done famously, he did it to that end. Though self-conscious men may be content to say that it was for his country, he did it to please his mother and to be proud. Soft, who comes here?
Worthy Minius Agrippa, one that hath always loved the people.
What work, my countrymen, is in hand? Where go you with bats and clubs? The matter? Speak, I pray you.
Our business is not unknown to the Senate. They say poor suitors have strong breaths. They shall see we have strong arms, too.
I tell you, friends, most charitable care have the patricians of you. And you slander the helms of the state, who care for you as fathers, when you curse them as enemies.
Care for us? They ne'er cared for us yet. Suffer us to starve, and their storehouses crammed with grain. Repeal daily any wholesome act established against the risk, and provide more piercing statutes daily to chain up and restrain the poor.
I shall tell you a pretty tale. It may be you have heard it before, but since it serves my purpose, I will venture to stale it a little more.
Well, I'll hear it, sir, but you must not think to fob off our disgrace with some tale.
There was a time when all the body's parts rebelled against the belly, thus accused it that only like a gulf it did remain in the midst of the body, idle and inactive, still cupboarding the bacon, never bearing like labor with the rest, where the other instruments did see and hear, devise, instruct, feel, walk, and mutually participate, did minister unto the appetite and affection common of the whole body. The belly answered.
Well, sir, what answer made the belly?
Well, I shall tell you.
You are long about it.
I will tell you.
What?
Note me, friends. Your most grave belly was deliberate, not rash like his accusers, and thus answered. True is it, my bodily friends, quoth he, that I receive the general food at first, which you do live upon. And fit it is, for I am the storehouse and the shop of the whole body. But if you do remember, I send it through the rivers of your blood, even to the court, the heart, the seat of the brain. And I can make my audit up, that all from me do back receive the flower of all, and leave me but the bran. What say you to it?
It was an answer. How apply you this?
The senators of Rome are this good belly, and you the mutinous members. For examine their counsels and their cares, and you shall find no public benefit which you receive, but it proceeds or comes from them to you, and no way from yourselves. What do you think? You, the great toe of this assembly.
I, the great toe? Why the great toe?
For that being one of the lowest, basest, poorest of this most wise rebellion, thou goest foremost. Hail, noble Martius.
Thanks. What's the matter, you dissentious rogues, that rubbing the poor itch of your opinion makes yourself scabs?
We have ever your good word.
Oh, he that would give good word to thee would flatter beneath abhorring. Well, what would you have, you cur, that like nor peace nor war? The one affrights you, the other makes you proud. He that trusts to you where he should find you lions, finds you hares, where foxes geese you are. Who deserves greatness deserves your hate. Hang ye, trust ye, with every minute you do change a mind and call him noble that was now your hate, him vile that was your garland. What's the matter? What's their seeking?
For corn at their own rates, whereof they say the city is well stored.
Oh, they say. They'll sit beside the fire and presume to know what's done in the capital. Who's like to rise, who thrives, who declines. Side factions and give out conjectural marriages such as stand not in their liking below their cobbled shoes. They say there's grain enough. Will the nobility lay aside their root and let me use my sword?
Nay, these are almost thoroughly persuaded. What says the other troop?
They're dissolved. Hang 'em. They sign forth proverbs that hunger broke stone walls, that meat was made for mouths. And with these shreds, they vented their complainings, which, being answered, a petition granted them.
What is granted them?
Two tribunes to defend their vulgar wisdoms. Sit death. The rabble should have first unroofed the city ere so prevailed with me. It will in time win forth greater themes for insurrection's arguing.
This is strange.
Go get you home, you fragments.
Martius, 'tis true that you've lately told us. The Volscis are in arms.
They have a leader, Tullus Aufidius, that will put you to it. I sin in envying his nobility. And were I anything but what I am, I would wish me only he.
You have fought together.
Were half to half the world by the ears and he upon my party, I'd revolt and make my wars on him. He is a lion I am proud to hunt.
Then, worthy Martius, attend upon Cominius to these wars.
It is your former promise.
Sir, it is, and I am constant.
Oh, true bred.
Your company to the capital.
Was ever man so proud as is this Martius?
He has no equal.
When we were chosen tribunes for the people,
marked you his lip and his eyes.
Nay, but his taunts.
Being moved, he will not spare to gird the gods.
We mock the modest moon.
The present wars devour him. He's grown too proud to be so valiant.
Such a nature, just tickled with success, disdains the shadow which he treads at noon. Let's hence and hear how this dispatch is made.
Let's along.
It is your opinion that spies of Rome have entered Volscian councils and know how we proceed.
Is it not yours? Whatever can be thought on in this state that can be brought to bodily act ere Rome had circumvention, 'tis not 4 days gone since I heard thence. These are the words. I have the message here. They have pressed a power. The famine is great, the people mutinous. And it is rumored, Cominius, Martius, your old enemy, who is of Rome most hated then of you, and Titus Lartius, a most valiant Roman. These three lead on a preparation, whether 'tis bent, most likely 'tis for Coriolis, consider of it.
Our army's in the field. We never yet made doubt but Rome was ready to answer us.
Nor did you think it folly to keep your great pretenses veiled to when they needs must show themselves, which, in the hatching, it seemed appear to Rome. Beseech you, recall my power and fortify your city.
Noble Aufidius, let us alone to guard Coriolis. If they set down before us for the remove, bring your army. But I think you'll find they're not prepared for us.
Oh, doubt not that. I speak from certainties, nay, more. Some of their parcels are forth already and only hear the word.
Recall your power. Coriolis gives you thanks. Noble Aufidius.
May the gods assist and keep your honor safe. If we and Caius Martius chance to meet, 'tis sworn between us we shall never strike till one can do no more.
express yourself in a more comfortable sort. If my son were my husband, I should freely rejoice in that absence wherein he won honor. His bed where he had shown most love. When yet he was but tender and the only son of my womb, I, considering how honor becomes such a person, was pleased to let him seek danger where he was like to find fame. To a cruel war I sent him, from whence he returned, his brows bound with oak. I tell thee, daughter, I sprang not more in joy at first hearing he was a man-child than now at first seeing he had proved himself a man.
But had he died in the business, madam, how then?
Then his good report should have been my son. Hear me profess sincerely. Had I a dozen sons, I'd rather 11 of them died nobly for their country than one voluptuously surfeit out of action.
Beseech you, give me leave to retire myself.
Oh, indeed, you shall not. Methinks I hear hither your husband's drum. See him pluck Aphidius down by the hair. The Volskys shunning him. See him stamp thus and call thus. Come on, you cowards! You're not fair though you're born in Rome. Then, with his mailed hand wiping his bloody brow.
His bloody brow? Oh, Jupiter, no blood!
Away, you fool! It more becomes a man than guilt his trophy.
Heavens bless my lord from Felophidius.
He'll beat Aphidius's head below his knee and tread upon his neck.
My ladies both, good day to you.
Sweet madam.
I am glad to see your ladyship.
How do you both? You are manifest housekeepers. What are you knitting there? A fine spot in good faith. How does your little son?
I thank your ladyship. Well, good, madam.
He'd rather see a sword and hear a drum than look upon his schoolmaster.
Oh, my word, the father's son. I'll swear, 'tis a very pretty boy. Has such a confirmed countenance. I saw him run after a gilded butterfly, and when he caught it, let it go again. And over he tumbles and catched it again. Or whether his fall enraged him, or how 'twas he did so, set his teeth and tear it.
Oh, one of his father's moods.
Indeed, la, 'tis a noble child. Come, lay aside your stitchery. I must have you play the idle housewife with me this afternoon.
No, good madam. I will not out of doors.
Not out of doors?
Oh, she shall. She shall.
Indeed, no, by your patience. I'll not over the threshold till my lord return from the wars.
Fie, you confine yourself most unreasonably. We must go visit the good lady that lies in.
I will wish her speedy strength and visit her with my prayers, but I cannot go thither.
Why, I pray you.
'Tis not to save labor, nor that I want love.
You would be another Penelope. Yet they say all the yarn she spun in Ulysses' absence did fill Ithaca full of moths. Come, you shall go with us.
No, good madam, pardon me. Indeed, I will not forth.
In truth, law, go with me, and I'll tell you excellent news of your husband.
Oh, good madam, there can be none yet.
Verily, I do not jest with you. There came news from him last night.
Indeed, madam?
In earnest, 'tis true. The Volscians have an army forth, against whom Cominius is gone. They are set down before the city Coriolis. They nothing doubt prevailing but to make it brief wars. This is the truth on mine honor, and so I pray you go with us.
Give me excuse, good madam, and I will obey you in everything hereafter.
Oh, let her alone, lady. As she is now, she will but disease our better mirth.
In troth, I think she would. Very well, then. Come, good sweet lady. Prithee, Virgilia, turn thy solemnness out of door and go with us?
No, at a word, madam. Indeed, I must not. I wish you much mirth.
Well, then, farewell.
Yonder comes news.
A wager they will yield.
My horse to yours?
No. 'Tis done.
Agreed.
Say, will the town surrender to our general?
The city rams its gates up against
so the good horse is mine.
Oh, I'll buy him of you.
No, I'll nor buy nor give him. Lend you him I will for 50 years. Now, Mars, I prithee, make us quick in work. Set me directly against Aphidius. Now, put your shields before your hearts and fight with hearts more proof than shields. Advance, my fellows. He that retires, I'll take on Varovalsky, and he shall feel mine edge. Plaster you o'er, that you may be aboard further than seen.
See, they have shut him in.
To the pot, I warrant him.
What has become of him?
Slain, ma'am. Doubtless.
He is himself alone to answer all the city. Oh, noble fellow, who sensibly outdares his senseless sword, and when it bows, stands up. Thou art lost, Martius.
Where is Martius?
Lost, sir. Alone he fights with Coriolis.
Oh, Martius, such manhood is called foolery where it stands against a falling fabric. Hadst thou but breathed, we should have come off like Romans, neither foolish in our stands nor cowardly in retire. Believe me, friends, we shall be charged again.
Look, sir!
Yonder, it does appear as he were flayed. Oh, gods, he has the stamp of Martius, and I have before time seen him thus.
So now the gates are open! Now prove good seconds!
Flower of warriors!
Worthy sir, thou bleedest. Thy exercise has been too violent for a second course of fight.
Ma'am, blaze me not. My work hath yet not warmed me. The blood I drop is rather physical than dangerous to me. To Aphidius thus I will appear and fight.
Though I could wish you were conducted to a gentle bath, and bombs applied to you, yet dare I never deny your asking.
If any such be here, as it were, sin to doubt that love this painting, wherein you see me smeared, if any fear lesser his person than an ill report, if anything brave death outweighs bad life, and that his country's dearer than himself, let him alone, or so many so minded, wave thus to express his disposition, and follow Mazas! I will fight with none but thee, for I do hate thee worse than a promise breaker.
We hate alike. Not Africans or serpents I abhor more than thy fame and envy.
Let the first butcher die, the other slave, and the gods doom him after.
If I fly, Martius, hollow me like a hare.
Within these 3 hours, Tullus, alone I fought in your Carioli's walls and made what work I pleased. For thy revenge, wrench up thy power to the highest.
With thou, Hector, thou shouldst not step me here.
Martius!
Officious and not valiant! You have shamed me in your condensed seconds!
If I should tell thee o'er this thy day's work, thou'st not believe thy deeds. But I'll report it where senators shall mingle tears with smiles, and where the dull tribunes that hate thine honors shall say against their hearts, we thank the gods our Rome hath such a soldier.
Pray now, no more. My mother, who has charred her to extol her, but when she does praise me, grieves me. I have done as you have done. That's what I can. Induced as you have been, that's for my country. He that has but affected his goodwill has o'ertained mine act.
You shall not be the grave of your deserving. Rome must know the value of her own. before our army, hear me.
I have wounds upon me, and they smart to hear themselves remembered.
Should they not, well might they fester against ingratitude and cure themselves with death. Of all the horses where we obtain good and good store, of all the treasure in this field achieved and city, we render you the tenth.
I thank you, General, but cannot make my heart consent to take a bribe to pay my sword. I do refuse it, and stand upon my common part with those that it be held to doing. May these instruments, which you profane, never sound more. When drums and trumpets sound the field prove flatterers, let courts and cities be filled with false face soothing no more, I say. For that I have not washed my nose that bled, or foiled some feeble wretch, which here's without note many else have done. You shot me forth in acclamations hyperbolical.
If against yourself you be incensed, we'll put you, like one that means to harm himself, in manacles, then reason safely with you. Therefore, be it known, as to us, to all the world, that Caius Martius wears this war's garland. And from this time forth, for what he did before Coriolis, call him with all the applause and clamor of the host, Caius Martius Coriolanus. Bear the addition nobly ever.
I will go wash my face, and when my face is fair, you shall see whether I blush or no. Howbeit, I thank you.
You must see a nurse. The blood upon your visage dries. It's time it should be looked to. Come.
The town is tame.
We'll be delivered back on good condition.
I were a Roman, for I would not, being a Volsky, be that I am. Condition. What good condition can a treaty find for the side that's defeated? 5 times, Martius, I have fought with thee. So often hast thou beat me, and wouldst do so, I think, should we encounter as often as we eat. By the elements, if e'er again I meet him face to face, he's mine, or I am his. Mine appetite hath not the honor in it had, for where I thought to crush him in equal force, true sword to sword, I'll potch at him some way, or raft or craft will get him.
He's the devil.
Bolder, though not so subtle. My valor's poison where I find him, in his home and sanctuary or in the capital. Naked, sick, asleep, nor prayers of priest, nor time of sacrifice. The rotten privilege against my hate to Martius. Wash my fierce hands and heart. Go you to the city, learn how 'tis held, and what they are that must be of hostages of Rome.
Will you not go?
I am attended at the Cypress Grove, I pray you. 'Tis south the city mills, bring me word thither how the world goes, that to the pace of it, I may spur on my journey.
I shall, sir.
The augurer tells me we shall have news tonight. Good or bad, not according to the prayer of the people. For they love not Martius.
Nature teaches beasts to know their friends.
Pray you, who does the wolf love?
The lamb.
I to devour him, as the hungry plebeians would the noble Martius.
He's a lamb indeed that baas like a bear.
He's a bear indeed that lives like a lamb. You two are wise ones. Tell me one thing that I shall ask you.
Well,
sir.
In what enormity is Martius poor in that you two have not in abundance?
He's poor in no one fault, but stored with all.
Especially in pride.
And topping all others in boasting.
This is strange now. Do you two know how you are censured here in the city? I mean, by us of the right-hand file. Do you?
How are we censured?
Why are we censured?
You blame Martius for being proud.
We do it not alone, sir.
I know you can do very little alone, for your helps are many. Your abilities are too infant-like for doing much alone. You talk of pride. Oh, that you could turn your eyes toward the napes of your necks and make but an interior survey of your good selves. Oh, that you could.
What then, sir?
Well, then you should find a brace of unmeriting, proud, violent, testy magistrates, alias fools, as any in Rome.
Menenius, you are known well enough, too.
I am known to be a humorous patrician, and one that loves a cup of hot wine with not a drop of diluting water in it. Hasty and tender-like upon too trivial motion. One that converses more with the buttock of the night than the forehead of the morning. What I think I utter, and spend my malice in my breath. What harm can your blind conspicuities glean out of this character, if I be known well enough too?
Come, sir, come. We know you well enough.
You know neither me, yourselves, nor anything. You are ambitious for poor knaves' caps and legs. You wear out a good, wholesome forenoon in hearing a cause between an orange wife and a faucet seller. Then adjourn the controversy of threepence to a second day of audience. You are a pair of strange ones.
Come, come. You are well understood to be a perfecter jiber for the table than a necessary bencher in the capital.
Good Eden to your worships. More of your conversation would infect my brain, being the herdsman of the beastly plebeians. I will be bold to take my leave of you. How now, my as fair as noble ladies, and the moon, were she earthly, no nobler. Whither do you follow your eyes so fast?
My boy Marcius approaches. For the love of Juno, let's go!
Marcius coming home?
Nay, 'tis true. Here's a message from him. And I think there's one for you.
I shall make my very house real tonight. A message for me?
Yes, 'tis certain there's one for you. I saw it.
Is he not wounded? He was wont to come home wounded.
Oh, no, no, no.
Oh, yes, he is wounded. I thank the gods for it.
So do I too, if it be not too much. Brings he victory in his pockets, the wounds become him.
On his brows, Menenius, he comes the third time home with the oaken garland.
Is the Senate possessed of this?
Yes, yes. The Senate has messages from the general, wherein he gives my son the whole name of the war. He hath in this action outdone his former deeds doubly.
God save your good worships. Marcius is coming home. He has more cause to be proud. Where is he wounded?
In his shoulder and the left arm, there will be two large cicatrices to show the people where, when he shall stand for his place. He hath received in the repulse of Tarquin 7 hurts in the body.
One in the neck and 2 in the thigh. There's 9 that I know of.
Before this last expedition, he had 25 wounds upon him.
Now it's 27, and every gash was an enemy's grave. Hark! The noise!
These are the ushers of Marcius. Before him he brings noise, yet behind him he leaves tears. Death, that dark spirit in his nervy arm doth lie, which, being advanced, declines, and then men die.
Know, Rome, that all alone Marcius did fight within Coriolis gates, where he hath won with fame a name to Caius Marcius. These in honor follows Coriolanus. Welcome to Rome, renowned Coriolanus.
Welcome to Rome, renowned Coriolanus.
No more of this. It does offend my heart. Pray now, no more.
Look, sir, your mother.
Oh, you have, I know, petitioned all the gods for my prosperity.
Nay, my good soldier, up. Gentle Marcius, worthy Caius, and by deed achieving honor, newly named, what is it? Coriolanus, must I call thee? Oh, thy wife.
My gracious silence, hail! Wouldst thou have laughed to see me come coffined home, that weeps to see me triumph? Nay, my dear, such eyes the widows and Cariolis wear in, and mothers that lack sons.
Now the gods crown thee,
and live you yet.
I know not where to turn. Welcome home, and welcome, General, and your welcome all.
100,000 welcomes. I could weep and I could laugh. I am light and heavy. Welcome. A curse begin at very root on his heart that is not glad to see you.
I had lived to see inherited my very wishes and the buildings of my fancy. Only there's one thing wanting, which I doubt not but our Rome will cast upon me.
No, good mother. I would rather be their servant in my way than sway with them in theirs.
On to the capital.
All tongues speak of him, and the bleared sights are spectacled to see him. Your prattling nurse into a rapture lets her baby cry while she chats him. The kitchen Malkin pins her richest lockram about her reachy neck, clamoring the walls to eye him. Such a pother, as if that whatsoever god who leads him were slyly crept into his human powers and given him graceful posture.
On the sudden, I warrant him consul.
Then our office may during his power go sleep.
He cannot temperately transport his honors from where he would begin and end, but will lose those that he hath won.
In that there is comfort.
Doubt not the commoners for whom we stand, but they, upon their ancient malice, will forget with the least cause these his new honors, which that he will give them and make I as little question as he is proud to do it.
I heard him swear, were he to stand for consul, never would he appear in the marketplace, nor on him put the napless vesture of humility, nor showing as the manner is his wounds to the people, beg their stinking breaths.
'Tis right.
It was his word.
I wish no better than to have him hold that purpose and put it in execution.
'Tis most like he will.
It shall be then as our good wills, a sure destruction.
Ah. So it must fall off to him or our authorities for an end. We must suggest the people in what hatred he still holds them?
Well, this, as you say, suggested at some time when his soaring insolence shall touch the people, will be his fire to kindle their dry stubble, and their blaze shall darken him.
Let's the capital. And carry with us ears and eyes for the time, but hearts for the event.
Having heard about the Volsces, it then remains as the main point of this our happy hour to gratify his noble service that hath thus stood for his country. Therefore, please you, most reverend and grave elders, to desire the present consul Cominius to report a little of that worthy work performed by Caius Martius Coriolanus.
Speak, good general. Leave nothing out for length. Masters of the people, we do request your kindest ears, and after the love emotion towards the common body, to yield what passes here.
Well, we both have hearts inclinable to both honor and advance the theme of our assembly.
Which the rather we shall be glad to do. If he remember a kinder value of the people than he hath there to prize them at.
That's off. I would rather you had been silent. He loves your people, but tie him not to be their bedfellow. Worthy Cominius, speak. Nay, keep your place.
Stay, Coriolanus.
Your honor's part, I would rather to have my wounds to heal again than hear say how I got them.
Sir, I hope my words dispensed you not.
No, sir, yet oft when blows have made me stay, I fled from words. I'll not stay now to hear my nothings monstered.
Proceed, Cominius.
I shall lack voice. The deeds of Coriolanus should not be uttered feebly. It is held that valor is the chiefest virtue and most dignifies the haver. If it be, The man I speak of cannot in the world be singly counterpoised. At 16 years, when Tarquin made a head for Rome, he fought beyond the mark of others. In that day's feats, when he might act the woman in the scene, he proved best man in the field. His pupil age, man entered thus, he waxed like a sea. And in the brunt of 17 battles since, he robbed all swords of the garland. For this last, before and in Coriolis, let me say, I cannot speak him home. As weeds before a vessel under sail, so men obeyed and fell below his stem. His sword, death's stamp, where it did mark, it took. From face to foot, he was a thing of blood, whose every motion was timed with dying cries. Alone, he entered the mortal gate of the city, which he painted with shunless destiny. Aidless, came off, and with a sudden reinforcement, struck Coriolis like a planet. Now all's his, when by and by the din of war can pierce his ready sense, then straight his doubled spirit re-quickened what in flesh was fatigate, and to the battle came he. Until we called both field and city ours, he never stood to ease his breast with panting.
Worthy man, he cannot but with measure fit the honors which we devise him.
He covets less than misery itself would give, rewards his deeds with doing them.
He's right noble. The Senate, Coriolanus, are well pleased to make thee consul.
I do owe them still my life and services.
It then remains that you do speak to the people.
I do beseech you. Let me o'erleap that custom. For I cannot put on the gown, stand naked, and entreat them for my wound's sake to give their suffrage. Please you, then may pass this doing.
But, sir, the people must have their voices. Neither will they bait one jot of ceremony.
It is a part that I shall blush in acting and might well be taken away from the people.
Mark you that?
To brag unto them, thus I did and thus, to show them the unaching scars as if I received them for the hire of their breath only.
Do not stand upon it. We recommend to you, tribunes of the people, our purpose to them. And to our noble consul, wish we all joy and honor.
To Coriolanus, come all joy and honor.
You see how he intends to use the people.
May they perceive his intent. On the marketplace, I know they do attend us.
If he do require our voices, madam, we ought not to deny him.
We may if we will.
Why, say, if he were to incline to the people, well, never was there a worthier man.
Here he comes, and with the gown of humility.
Mark his behavior.
Now, you are not to all stay together, but shall come by him where he stands, by ones and by twos. Every one of you has a single honor in giving to him your own voices with our own tongues.
Content, content.
What must I say? Plague upon it! I cannot bring my tongue to such a pace. Oh, look, sir, of my wounds, sir, I got them in my country's service, when some certain of your brethren roared and ran from the noises of their own drums.
Oh, me the gods, you must not speak of that. You must desire them to think upon you.
Think upon me? I would they would forget me.
You'll mar all. I'll leave you. Pray you speak to him, I pray you, in wholesome manner.
Oh, bid them wash their faces and keep their teeth clean. So here comes a brace. You know the cause, ladies of my standing here.
We do, sir. Tell us what hath brought you to it.
Mine own desert.
Your own desert?
Aye, but not mine own desire.
How not your own desire?
No, miss. 'Twas never my desire yet to trouble the poor with begging.
You must think If we give you anything, we hope to gain by you.
Well then, I pray, your price of the councilship.
The price is to ask it kindly.
Kindly? Madam, I pray, let me have it. I have wounds to show you, which shall be yours in private. Your good voice, miss, what say you? A match, miss? Well, there's an all too worthy voices begged. I pray you, if it may stand by the tune of your voices, that I may be counsel. I have here the customary gown.
You have deserved nobly of your country, and you have not deserved nobly.
Your enigma?
You have been a scourge to her enemies, you have been a rod to her friends, and you have not indeed loved the common people.
You should have caught me the more virtuous that I have not been common in my love. I will, miss, flatter my sworn brother the people to earn a dearer estimation of them. 'Tis a condition they account gentle. And since the wisdom of their choice is rather to have my hat than to have my heart, then I'll practice the insinuating nod and be off to them most counterfeitedly. Therefore, I beseech you, miss, I may be counsel.
You have received many wounds for your country.
Oh, not seal your knowledge now with showing them. Oh, most sweet voices. Better it is to die, better to starve, than to crave the hire which first we do deserve. Why, in this wolvish togue, must I stand here to beg of Hob and Dick that does appear their needless vouches? Custom calls me to it. And what custom wills in all things, we must do it. The dust on antique time lie unswept, and mountainous air be too highly heaped for truth to o'erpeer. Rather than fool it so, let the high honor and office go to one that would do thus. I am half through, the one part suffered, the other will I do. Your voices, for your voices I have fought, watched. For your voices bear of wounds, 24 odd battles, thrice 6 I have seen and heard of. Your voices have done many things, some less, some more. Your voices, indeed, I would be counsel.
Amen, amen. God save thee, worthy counsel.
Worthy voices.
You've withstood your limitation, and the tribunes endow you with the people's voice.
Is this done?
The custom of request you have discharged. The people do admit you and are summoned to meet anon upon your approbation.
Where? At the Senate House?
There, Coriolanus.
May I change these garments?
You may, sir.
That I'll straight do, and knowing myself again, repair to the Senate House.
I'll keep you company. Will you along?
We stay here for the people.
Fare you well. Have you chose this man?
He has our voices, madam.
We pray the gods he may deserve your love.
Amen, sir. To my poor and worthy notice, he mocked us when he begged our voices.
Certainly. He flouted us downright.
No, it's 'tis kind of speech. He did not mock us.
He used us scornfully. He should have showed us his marks of merit, wounds received for his country.
Well, so he did, I'm sure.
No man saw them.
He said he had wounds, which he could show in private, and with his hat thus waving it in scorn, I would be counsel, says he. That being granted, your voices, I thank you, your most sweet voices. Now that you have left your voices, I have no further with you. Was this not mockery?
Either you were ignorant to see it, or seeing it of such childish friendliness to yield your voices.
Did you not perceive? He did solicit you in free contempt when he did need your loves. And do you think that his contempt shall not be bruising to you when he hath power to crush? What? Hath your bodies no heart among you?
He's not confirmed. We may deny him yet.
And will deny him. I'll have 500 voices of that sound.
Aye, twice 500 and friends to peace him.
Get you hence instantly, and tell those friends they have chose a consul that will from them take their liberties.
I'll let them assemble. And in safer judgment, I'll revoke your ignorant election. Enforce his old pride and hate unto you. Besides, forget not with what contempt he wore the humble robe, how in his suit he scorned you. But your loves, thinking of his services, took from you the apprehension of his present portents.
Lay a fault on us, your tributes.
Say you chose him guided more after our commandment than by your own true affections. Lay the fault on us.
Aye, spare us not. Say we read lectures to you, how youngly he began to serve his country, how long continued, and what stock he springs of.
You ne'er had done it but by our putting on.
Go now, draw your number to the capital.
To the capital, go! And we will be there before a stream of people. And this will seem, as partly it is, their own, which we have goaded onward.
He has the people's voice, and the Senate is pleased to name him consul. Coriolanus, this message is returned and brings report that Rome's great enemy has made new head.
So then the Volsci stand but as at first, ready when time shall prompt them to make road upon us again.
They are worn, Lord Consul, so that we shall hardly in our ages see their banners wave again.
Saw you Aufidius?
On safeguard he did come to me, and he cursed against the Volsci, for they had so vilely yielded the town. He is retired to Antium.
Spoke he of me?
He did, my lord.
How? What?
How often he had met you, sword to sword. That of all things upon the earth, he hated your person most, and that he would pawn his fortunes and hopeless restitution just to be called your vanquisher.
At Antium lives he.
At Antium.
I wish I had cause to seek him there, to oppose his hatred fully. Behold, these are the tribunes of the people, the tongues of the common mouth.
What's this?
The matter?
The people are incensed.
They cry. They are at a point to lose their liberties. Marcius would have all from them.
Marcius, whom late you have named for consul.
What makes this change?
Hath he not passed the noble and the common?
Cominius, no.
Have I had children's voices?
He shall to the marketplace and test it there.
I beseech you to stay here by the Senate. It will be dangerous to go on no further.
Remain within, or all will fall in broil.
Tribunes, give way.
Give way?
Are these your herd? Must these have voices that can yield them now and straight disclaim their tongues? What are your offices? You being their mouths, why rule you not their teeth? Have you set them on?
Be calm, be calm.
It is a purpose thing, and it grows by plot to curb the will of the nobility. Suffer it, and live with such as cannot rule nor ever will be ruled.
Call it not a plot. The people cry you mock them, and of late, when corn was given them gratis, you repine. Scandaled the suppliants for the people, called them time-pleasers, flatterers, foes to nobleness.
Why, this was known before.
Not to them all.
Have you informed them since?
Let's...
Ha! I informed them!
You are like to do such business.
Calm. People are abused, set on. This paltering becomes not Rome.
Tell me of corn. This was my speech, and I will speak it again.
Not now. Not now.
Now as I live, I will, my nobler friends. I crave their pardons.
Tribunes both give way.
For the mutable rank scented many, let them regard me as I do not flatter, and therein behold themselves. I say again, and soothing them, we nourish against our sin the cockle of rebellion, insolence, sedition, which we ourselves have plowed for, sowed, and scattered by mingling them with us, the honored number, who lack not virtue, no nor power, but that which they had given to beggars.
Well, enough.
We thank you, no more words, pray.
How, no more words? As for my country, I have shed my blood, not fearing outward force. Shall sound my lungs cornwards till their decay against these measles, which we disdain to tatter us, yet sought the very way to catch them.
You speak of the people as if you were a god to punish.
Sure, well, we let the people know it.
What? What, his collar?
Collar? Were as patient as a midnight sleep, by Jove, 'twould be my mind.
It is a mind that shall remain a poison where it is, oh. Not poison any further.
Shall remain. Ooh, mark you, everyone, this Triton of the Menos, mark you, her absolute shall.
Was from the canon.
Shall, oh good, but most unwise patricians. Why, you grave but reckless senators, have you thus given Hydra here to choose an officer that with her peremptory shall, being but the horn and noise of the monsters, wants not spirit to say she'll turn your current in a ditch and make your channel hers? If she have power, veil your ignorance. If none, awake your dangerous lenity.
Well, no more of that.
Why should the people give their voice to one who speaks thus?
I'll give my reasons more worthy than their voices.
Come, enough!
Enough with overmeasure!
This double worship, where one part does disdain with cause, the other insult without all reason, where gentlety, title, wisdom cannot conclude but by the yeah and no of general ignorance. Purpose so barred it follows. Nothing is done to purpose. Therefore, I beseech you, you that would be less cowardly than wise, that love the fundamental part of the state more than you fear the change on it, and prefer a noble life before a long, pluck out the multitudinous tongue. Let them not lick the sweet which is their poison. Your dishonor mangles true judgment and bereaves the state of that integrity which should become it, not having the power to do the good it would, or the ill that doth control it.
Has said enough.
Has spoken like a traitor, and shall answer as traitors do.
This a consul? No. Let him be apprehended.
Hence, you goat.
Go, call the people, in whose name myself attach thee as a traitorous innovator. An enemy of the people.
Hence, rotten things, or I shall shake thy bones out of thy garments.
Rude, sir, hands off.
On both sides, more respect.
Obey! We charge thee and follow through to thine answer.
This is the way to kindle, not to quench.
To unbuild a city and lay off flats.
And what is the city, sir, but the people?
By the consent of all, we were established the people's magistrates.
That is the way to lay the city flat. To bring the roof to the foundation and bury all.
This deserves death.
Or let us stand to our authority.
Oh my God.
Or let us lose it. We do here pronounce upon the part of the people in whose power we were elected theirs, Martius is worthy of present death.
Therefore bear him to the rock Tarpeian. And from thence into destruction cast him.
No, I'll die here. There's some among you have beheld me fighting. Come, try upon yourselves what you have seen me.
Down with that knife. What, have you lost your wits?
Call the citizen!
Lay hands upon him.
Go get you to your house. Be gone.
Stand fast. We have as many friends as enemies.
Shall it be put to this?
Oh, the gods forbid.
Tribunes, withdraw a while.
He is a viper who would depopulate the city and be every man himself.
Be what you seem to be, truly your country's friends, and pray withdraw. I'll undertake to bring him by and by, where he shall answer by a lawful form.
On the marketplace, we shall attend you.
That man has marred his fortune. His nature is too noble for the world. He would not flatter Neptune for his trident, or Jove for his power to thunder. His heart's his mouth. What his breast forges, that his tongue must vent. And being angry does forget that ever he heard the name of death. This must be patched with cloth of any color.
I'm amused my mother does not approve me further, who was wont to call them woolen vassals, things to buy and sell with groats, to show bare heads in congregations, to yawn, be still and wonder, when one but of my ordinance stood up to speak of peace and war. I talk of you. Why did you wish me milder? Would you have me false to my nature? Rather say I play the man I am.
Oh, sir. I would have had you put your power well on before you had worn it out.
Let go.
You might have been enough the man you are with striving less to be so.
Come, you have been too rough, something too rough. You must return and mend it.
Let them hang.
Aye, and burn too. I have a heart as little apt as yours, but yet a brain that leads my use of anger to better vantage.
Well said, noble woman.
Pray, be counseled.
Well, what must I do?
Return to the tribunes.
Well, what then? What then?
Repent what you have spoke.
To them? I cannot do it to the gods. Must I do it to them?
You are too absolute. Go there and you can never be too noble. But when extremities speak, I have heard you say that honor and policy, like unsevered friends, do grow together in the war. Grant that and tell me in peace what each by the other lose that they combine not there.
Tush, tush.
A good demand.
If it be honor in your policy to be the same, you are not, which for your best ends you adopt your policy, how is it less or worse that it shall hold companionship in peace with honor as in war, since that to both it stands in like request?
Why force you this?
Because that now it stands on you to speak to the people, not by your own instruction, nor by the matter which your heart prompts you, but with such words that are but rooted in your tongue, though but bastards and syllables of no allowance to your bosom's truth. I am in this, your wife, your son, these senators, the nobles, and you will rather show our general louts how you can frown than spend a thorn upon them for the inheritance of their loves or the safeguard of what that want might ruin.
Noble woman, come go with us. You may solve so. Not what is dangerous present, but the loss of what is past.
I pray thee, my son, go to them with this around thy neck. And thus far having stretched it, here be with them, thy knee blessing the stones. For in such business, action is eloquence.
This but done, even as she speaks, why, their hearts were yours, for they will pardon being asked.
Prithee now, my son, go and be ruled. Though I know that thou hadst rather follow thine enemy in a fiery gulf than flatter him in a bower. Here's Cominius.
I've been in the marketplace, and, sir, 'tis fit you make strong party. Or defend yourself by calmness or by absence, all within anger.
Fair speech only.
I think 'twill serve, if he can thereto frame his spirit.
He must and will. Pray, say you will and go about it.
Must I with base tongue give unto my noble heart a lie that it must bear? Well, I will do it. Yet were there but this single plot to lose, this mold of Martius, they to dust should grind it and throw it against the wind. You have put me now to such a part which never I shall discharge to the life.
Come, we'll prompt you.
Prithee, my sweet, sweet son, as thou hast said, my praises made thee first a soldier. So, to have my praise for this, perform a part that thou hadst not done before.
Well, I must do it. Away my disposition and possess me some harlot spirit. Or my throat of war be turned, which quired of my drum, into a pipe as small as a eunuch, or the virgin's voice, that babies lulls asleep. I will not do it, lest I should cease to honor mine own truth, and by my body's action teach my mind a most inherent baseness.
At thy choice, then, to beg of thee is my more dishonor than now of them. Come all to ruin! Let thy mother rather feel thy pride than fear thy stubbornness, for I mock at death with as great a heart as thou. Do as thou list, thy valiantness was mine. Thou suck'st it from me, but owe thy pride thyself.
Pray be content. Mother, I am going to the marketplace. Chide me no further. I'll cog their hearts from them, mountebank their loves, and come home beloved of all the trades in Rome. Look, I am going. Commend me to my wife. I'll return counsel, or never trust to what my tongue can do in the way of flattery further.
Do your will.
Away. The tribunes do attend you. Arm yourself to answer mildly, for they are prepared with accusations, as I hear, more strong than are upon you yet.
The word is mildly. Pray you, let us go. Let them accuse me by invention, and I'll answer in mine honor.
Aye, but mildly.
Oh, mildly be it then. Mildly.
Charge him home, that he affects tyrannical power. If he evade us there, enforce him with his envy to the people, and how the spoil got to Coriolis was ne'er distributed. What? Will he come?
He's coming.
How accompanied?
But with Menenius and those senators that always favored him.
Have you a catalog of all the voices we have procured, set down by the poll?
I have. 'Tis ready.
And have you collected them by tribe?
I have.
Well, then assemble presently the people hither, and when they hear me cry, it shall be so, for in the cause of death, fine, or banishment, then if they hear me cry fine, if death, cry death, insisting on the old prerogative and power in the truth of the cause.
I shall inform them.
Make them be right and ready for this hint when we are hap to give it them.
Go about it. Put them to collar straight.
Pray, I beseech you, calm.
The honored gods keep Rome in safety, and the chairs of justice supplied with worthy men plant love among us, throng our large temples with the shows of peace, and not our streets with war.
Amen.
A noble wish.
Draw near, ye people.
List to your tribunes. Audience, peace, I say.
First, hear me speak.
Well, say, peace, ho.
Shall I be charged no further than this present? Must all be determined here?
I do demand, if you submit you to the people's voices, allow their officers, and are content to suffer lawful censure for such faults as shall be proved upon you.
I am content.
Lo, citizens, he says he is content. The warlike service he has done, consider. Think upon the wounds his body bears, which show like graves in a holy churchyard.
Scratches with briars, scars to move laughter only.
Consider further that when he speaks not like a citizen, you find him like a soldier. Do not take his rougher accents for malicious sounds.
Well, no more.
What's the matter that, being passed for counsel, I am so dishonored that the very hour you take it off again?
Answer to us.
Say then, 'tis true, I ought so.
We charge you that you have contrived to take from Rome all seasoned office, and to wind yourself into a power tyrannical, for that you are a traitor to the people.
How? Traitor?
Nay, temperately, your promise.
Should 20,000 deaths sit in thine eyes, as many millions clutch within thy hands, I'd say, thou liest, with a voice as free as I do pray to the gods.
Mark you that, people?
To the rock with him!
Now, peace. We need not add new matter to his charge. What you have seen him do, and heard him say, beating your officers, cursing yourselves, opposing laws with strokes and here, defying those whose great power must try him. Even this so criminal and of such capital kind deserves the extremest death.
But since he hath served well for Rome.
What are you, prate of service?
I talk as one that knows it.
You.
Is this the promise that you made your mother?
No, I pray you.
I know no further. Let them pronounce the steep Tarpeian death, vagabond exile, reign, Pentalinga, but with one grain a day. I would not buy their mercy at the price of one fair word, nor check my courage for what they can give to have it with saying good morrow.
For that he has as much as in him lies. From time to time, envied against the people, seeking means to pluck away their power. And in the name of the people, and in the power of us, the tribunes, we even in this instant banish him our city, in peril of precipitation from off the rock Tarpeian, never more to enter our Rome gates. In the name of the people, I say, it shall be so!
It shall be so!
Hear me, my masters and my common friends.
He is sentenced no more hearing.
Let me speak. I have been consul and can show for Rome her enemies' marks upon me. I do love my country's good with a respect more tender, more holy and profound than mine own life, my dear wife's estimate, her womb's increase and treasure of my loins. Then, if I would speak that—
There's no more to be said, but he is banished as enemy of the people and his country. It shall be so.
It shall be so!
You common cry of curs, whose breath I hate as reek as the rotten fens, whose love I prize as the dead carcasses of unburied men that do corrupt my air. I banish you. And here remain with your uncertainty. Let every feeble rumor shake your hearts. Your enemies, with nodding of their plumes, fan you into despair. Have the power still to banish your defenders. Your ignorance, which finds not till it feels, making not reservation for yourselves, still your own foes. Deliver you as most abated captives to some nation that won you without blows. Despising you, for thus the city I turn my back. There is a world elsewhere.
Thank you.
tears, a brief farewell. The beast with many heads butts me away. Nay, mother, where is your ancient courage? You were used to say extremity was the trier of spirits, that common chances common men could bear, that when the sea was calm, all boats alike showed mastership in floating.
Oh, heavens!
Nay, prithee, woman.
Now the red pestilence strike all trades in Rome, and occupations perish.
What? I shall be loved when I am lacked. Nay, mother, resume that spirit. When you were wont to say that if you had been Hercules' wife, six of his labors you'd have done to save your husband so much sweat. Menenius, droop not. Adieu. Farewell, my wife, my mother. I'll do well yet. My sometime general, I have seen thee stern, and thou hast oft beheld heart-hardening spectacles. Tell these sad women, 'tis fond to wail inevitable strokes, as 'tis to laugh at them. My mother, you wot well, my hazards still have been your solace. And though I go alone, like to a lonely dragon, that his fen makes more feared and talked of than seen. Your son will or exceed the common, or be caught with cautelous baits and in practice.
My first son, whither wilt thou go? Take good Cominius with thee a while.
Oh, the gods.
Yes.
I'll follow thee a month, devise with thee where thou shalt rest, that thou mayest hear of us and we of thee. So if the time thrust forth a cause for thy repeal, we shall not send o'er the vast world to seek a single man.
Fare thee well. Thou hast years upon thee, and thou art too full of the war's surfeits to go rove with one that's yet unbruised. Bring me but out to the gate. Come, my wife, my sweet, dearest mother, my friends of noble touch. When I am forth, bid me farewell and smile. While I remain above the ground, you shall hear from me still, and never aught of me but what is like me formerly.
That's worthily as any ear can hear. Come, let's not weep.
Give me thy hand.
See him out of gates. Follow him as he hath followed you, with all despite. We'll give him deserved vexation. Let a guard attend us through the city. He's gone, and we'll no further. Oh, the nobility are vexed with whom we've sided in his behalf.
Now we have shown our power. Let us seem humbler after it is doing.
Bid them home. Say their great enemy is gone, and they stand in their ancient strength.
Here comes his mother.
Oh, let's not meet her.
Why?
They say she's mad. So just make sure you go.
They've taken note of us.
We are well met. The hoarded plague of the gods requite your love.
Peace, be not so loud.
If that I could for weeping, you should hear. Nay. And you shall hear some. Will you be gone?
You shall stay too. I would I had the power to say so to my husband.
What are you, mankind?
Oh! Are you mankind? No, but this fool. Was not a man my father? Hast thou foxship to banish him that struck more blows for Rome than thou hast spoken words? Yet more noble blows than ever thou wise words, and for Rome's good. I'll tell thee what. Yet go. Nay, but thou shalt stay too. I would my son were in Arabia and thy tribes before him, his good sword in his hand. Oh, blessed heavens.
Well, what then?
What then? He'd make an end of thy posterity!
Bastards and all. Good man. The wounds he does bear for Rome.
Come, peace.
I would he had continued to his country as he began, not unknit himself the noble knot he made.
I would he had.
The noble knot. I would he had. I would he had. 'Twas you incensed the rabble.
Pray, let us go.
Pray, get you gone. You have done a brave deed. Ere you go, hear this. As far as doth exceed the capital of the meanest house in Rome, so far my son, whom you have banished, does exceed you all.
Well, well, we'll leave you.
Why stay we to be baited by one who wants her wits? Oh, come on. Take my prayers with you! I would the gods had nothing better to do but to confirm my curses! Could I meet him but once a day, it would unclog my heart of what lies heavy to it!
You have told them home, and by my troth you have cause. You'll sup with me?
Anger's my meat. I'll sup upon myself, and so shall starve with feeding. Let's go. Leave this faint pulling and lament as I do. In anger, Juno-like. Come. Come! Come!
Fie! Fie! Fie!
Goodly city is this Antium. City, 'tis I that made thy widows. Many an heir of these fair edifices for my wars have I heard groan and drop. Then know me not, lest that thy wives with spits and boys with stones in puny battle slay me. Save you, sir?
And you.
Direct me, if it be your will, where the great Aufidius lies. Is he in Antium?
He is, and feasts the nobles of the state at his house this night.
Which is his house, beseech you?
This here before you.
Thank you, sir. Farewell.
Why?
Wine.
Where's Cotus? My master calls for him. Cotus!
A goodly house. The feast smells well, but I appear not like a guest.
What would you have, sir? Whence are you? Here is no place for you. Pray, go to the door.
I deserve no better entertainment in being Coriolanus.
Whence are you, sir? Has the porter his eyes in his head that he gives entrance to such companions?
Away.
Away? Get you away!
Oh, now thou art troublesome.
Are you so brave? I'll have you talked with anon. Guard.
Oh, what fellow's this?
A strange one as ever I looked on. I can't get him out of the house.
What have you to do here, fellow? Pray you, avoid the house.
Let me but stand. I will not hurt your hearth.
Oh, what are you?
A gentleman.
A marvelous poor one.
True, so I am.
Pray you, poor gentleman, pick up some other station. Here is no place for you. Pray you avoid.
Follow your function. Go in batten on cold bits.
Oh, what? You will not? Prithee, tell my master what a strange guest he has here.
And I shall.
Where dwellest thou?
Under a canopy.
Under a canopy?
Aye.
Where's that?
In the city of kites and crows.
Ooh, in the city of kites and crows. What an ass it is. Does thou dwellest with daws too?
No, I'll not serve thy master.
How, sir, do you meddle with my master?
'Tis an honor to service and to meddle with thy mistress, thou praetus and praetus. Serve with thy trencher hence.
Where is this fellow?
Here, sir. I'd have beaten him like a dog, but for disturbing the lords within.
Whence comest thou? What? What is thou? Thy name? Why speakest not? Speak, man! What's thy name?
If Tullus, thou not knowest me and seeing me, dost not know me for the man I am, necessity commands me name myself.
What's thy name?
A name unmusical to Volscian ears and harsh in sound to thine.
Say, what's thy name? Thou hast a grim appearance, and thy face bears a command to it. Though thy tassel's torn, thou showest a noble net vessel.
What's thy name? Prepare thy brow to frown. My name is Caius Marcius. Who hath done to thee particularly and to all Volsces great hurt and mischief. Thereto witness may my surname, Coriolanus. The painful service, the extreme dangers and drops of blood shed for my thankless country are requited but with that surname. A good memory to the malice and displeasure which thou shouldst bear me, only that name remains. The cruelty and envy of the people, permitted by our dastard nobles who have all forsook me, hath devoured the rest, and suffered me by the voices of slaves to be whooped out of Rome. Now this extremity hath brought me to thy heart, not out of hope, mistake me not, for if I had feared death of all the men in the world, I would have voided thee. But out of mere spite to be full quit of those my banishers, stand I before thee here. Now, if thou hast a heart of wreak in thee, that wilt revenge thine own particular wrongs, and stop those manes of shame seen throughout thy country, speed thee straight, and make my misery serve thy turn. So use it that my vengeful services may prove as benefits to thee. For I will fight against my cankered country with the spleen of all the underfiends. But if so be thou darest not this, and that to prove more fortunes thou art tired, I am also longer to live, most weary. And I present my throat to thee and thy ancient malice, which not to cut would prove thee but a fool, since I have ever followed thee with hate, drawn tons of blood out of thy country's best, and cannot live unless it be to do thee service.
Oh, Marcius, Marcius, each word thou hast spoke hath weeded from my heart a root of ancient envy. If Jupiter should yon cloud speak divine things and say 'tis true, well, I'd not believe them more than thee, thou noble Marcius. Let me twine mine arms about that body, where against my grained ash 100 times hath broke, and scar the moon with splinters. Here, I clip the anvil of my sword, and do contest as hotly and as nobly as thy love, as ever in ambitious strength I did contend against thy valor. Know thee first, I loved the maid I married. Never man sighed truer breath. But did I see thee here, thou noble thing? More dances my rapt heart than when first wedded my mistress saw bestride my threshold. Thou hast beat me out 12 several times, and I have since nightly dreamt of such encounters twixt thyself and me. Oh, we have been down together in my sleep, on buckled helms, fisting each other's throat, and waked half dead with nothing. Worthy Marcius, had we no quarrel else to roam, but that art thence banished, we would muster off from 12 to 70, and pouring war into the bowels of ungrateful Rome. Oh, come, ruin. Mama. Oh. You bless me, gods. Therefore, most absolute sir, if thine wilt have the leading of thine own revenges, take the one half of my commission, and set down as best thou art experienced. Since thou knowest thy country's strengths and weaknesses, thine own ways, whether to knock on the gates of Rome, or rudely visit them in parts remote, to fright them ere destroy. But come, allow me to command them first, that shall say yea to thy desires. 1,000 welcomes!
Are bound to pray for you both.
Kind neighbors, we wish Coriolanus had loved you as we did.
We hear not of him, neither need we fear him.
We stood to it in good time. Mm. Is this Menenius?
Tis he. Oh, he is grown most kind of late. Mm.
Hail, sir!
Hail to you both.
Your Coriolanus is not much missed, but with his friends, while the Commonwealth doth stand, and so would do were he more angry at it.
All's well, and might have been much better if he could have temporized.
Huh? Where is he, hear you?
I hear nothing. His mother, his wife, his children hear nothing.
Well, this is a happier and more comely time than when these fellows ran about the streets crying confusion.
Rome sits safe and still.
What? Worthy tribunes, look, there has been a slave whom we have put in prison. Reports the Volsces with 2 several powers are entered into the Roman territories and with the deepest malice of the war, destroy what lies before them.
'Tis Aufidius, who, hearing of our Martius' exile, thrusts forth his head into our world again.
Oh, come you, what talk you of Martius?
Go see this rumor and wept! It cannot be the fool she's dead break with us.
Cannot be, we have record that very well it can. And 3 examples of the like have been within my age.
Oh, tell not me. I know this cannot be.
Not possible.
Menenius, you are sent for to the Senate. The nobles in great earnestness are going all to the capital. Some news has come that turns their countenances. The slave's report is seconded, and more fearful is delivered. It is spoke freely out of many mouths. How probable I do not know that Martius joined with Aufidius? Leads a power against Rome and vows revenge as spaces in between as the youngest and the oldest thing.
Well, this is most likely.
Raised only, that the weaker sort may wish good Martius home again.
Oh, the very trick on it.
This is unlikely. He and Aufidius can no more atone than violentest contrariety.
Oh, you have made good work.
What news?
Oh, you have helped to ravish your own daughters, to melt the city leads upon your pates, to see your wives dishonored to your noses.
Pray, your news. You have made fair work, I fear me, if Martius be joined with Volscians.
If? He is their god. He leads them like a thing made by some other deity than nature that shapes man better. And they follow him against us brats with no less confidence than boys pursuing summer butterflies, or butchers killing flies.
You have made good work. You and your apron men, you that stood so much upon the voice of occupation and the breath of garlic eaters.
We will shake your Rome about your ears.
Oh, you have made fair work. Is this true, sir?
Aye, and you'll look pale before you find it other. He's now camped at Coriolis, and all the regions do smilingly revolt. Those who resist are mocked for valiant ignorance and perish constant fools. Who is't can blame him? Your enemies and his find something in him.
We are all undone unless the nobleman have mercy.
Who shall ask it? The tribunes cannot do it for shame. The people deserve such pity of him as the wolf does of the shepherds. For his best friends, how may they say, be good to Rome? They charged him even as those should do that had deserved his hate, and therein showed like enemies.
'Tis true. If he were putting to my house the brand that should consume it, I have not the face to say, beseech you cease. Oh, you have made fair hands, you and your crafts. You have crafted fair.
You have brought a trembling upon Rome such as was never so incapable of help.
Now say not we brought it.
How was it we? We loved him, but like beasts and cowardly nobles, gave way unto your clusters who did hoot him out of the city.
But I fear they'll roar him in again. Tullus Aufidius, the second name of men, obeys his points as if he were his officer. Desperation is all the policy, strength, and defense that Rome can make against them.
And is Aufidius with him? You are they that made the air unwholesome when you cast your stinking greasy caps in hooting at Coriolanus' exile. Now he's coming, and not a hair upon a soldier's head, which will not prove a whip. As many heads as you threw up will he cast down and pay you for your voices. Oh, 'tis no matter. If he could burn us all into one coal, we have deserved it.
For mine own part, when I said banish him, I said it 'twas pity.
And so did I.
And so did I. And to say the truth, so did many of us. That we did for the best. And though we willingly consented to his banishment, yet it was against our will.
You're goodly things, you voices.
You have made good work, you and your cry. Shall us to the capital?
Oh, aye, what else?
We'll get you home, my masters. Be not dismayed. These are a side that would be glad to have this true, which they so seem to fear. Get you home, show no signs of fear. Come, masters, let's home. I knew we were in the wrong when we banished him.
So did we all, but come, let's home.
I do not like this news.
Nor I.
Let's to the capital. Would half my wealth would buy this for a lie.
Oh, let's pray, let us go.
Do they still flock to the Roman?
I do not know what witchcraft's in him, but your soldiers use him as grace for meat, their talk at table, and their thanks at end. And you are darkened in this action, sir, even by your own.
I cannot help it now. Unless, by trickery, I lame the foot of our design. He bears himself more proudlier, even to my person, when first I did embrace him. Yet his nature in that's no changeling. And I must excuse what cannot be amended.
Yet I wish, sir, I mean for your particular, that you had not joined in commission with him, but either had borne the action of yourself, or to him had left it solely.
I understand thee well, and be thou sure, when he shall come to his account, he knows not what I can urge against him, although it seems, and so he thinks, and is no less apparent to the vulgar eye that he bears all things proudlier. He shows great husbandry to the Volscan states, fights dragon-like, and does achieve as soon as strike his sword.
Sir, I beseech you, think you he'll carry Rome?
One fire drives out one fire. One nail, rights by rights do falter, strengths by strengths do fail. Come, let's away. If Caius, Rome is thine, thou art poorest of all, then shortly art thou mine.
So, you heard what he has said to him, which was his general, who he loved in a most dear particular. He called me father, but what of that? Go, you that banished him, a mile before his tent, fall down and kneel your way into his mercy. Nay, if he coyed to hear good Cominius speak, I'll keep at home.
He would not seem to know me.
Do you hear?
Yet one time he did call me by my name. I urged our old acquaintance and the drops that we have bled together. Coriolanus he would not answer to, forbade all names. He was a kind of nothing, titleless, till he had forged himself a name of the fire of burning Rome.
Why, so you have made good work.
I minded him how royal 'twas to pardon when it was less expected. He replied, it was a poor petition of estate to one whom they had punished.
Very well. Could he say less?
I offered to awaken his regard for his private friends. His answer to me was, he could not stay to pick them from a pile of noisome, musty chaff. He said 'twas folly for one poor grain or two to leave unburnt and still to nose the offense.
For one poor grain or two. I am one of those. His mother, his wife, his child, and this brave fellow here, we are the grains. You are the musty chaff, and you are smelt above the moon. We must be burnt for you.
Nay. Pray, be patient. If you refuse your aid in this so never needed help, yet do not upbraids in our distress. But if you would be your country's pleader, your good tongue, more than the instant army we can make, might stop our countrymen.
No, I'll not meddle.
Pray you.
What should
go
I say?
To him.
What should I say?
Only make trial what your love can do for Rome. Towards Martius.
Well, and say he returned me as Martius is returned, unheard. What then? But as a discontented friend, grief shot at his unkindness. Say it be so.
Then take Rome's hands as you intended well.
I'll undertake it. I think he'll hear me. Yet, to bite his lip and hum at good Cominius much unhearts me, he was not taken well. He had not dined. The veins unfilled, our blood is cold, and then we are apt to pout upon the morning, are unapt to give or to forgive. But when we have filled, when we have stuffed these and these conveyances of our blood with wine and feedings, we are suppler souls than in our priest-like fasts. Therefore, I'll undertake to wait until he be dieted to my request, and then I'll set upon him.
You know the very road unto his kindness, and cannot lose your way.
God grant me. Prove him I will, speed how it will. I shall ere long have knowledge of my success.
He'll never hear him.
Not?
I tell you, he does sit in gold. His eye red as 'twould burn Rome, and his injury the jailer to his pity. I kneeled before him. 'Twas very faintly he said, "Rise." Dismissed me thus with his speechless hand. What he would do, he sent in writing after me. What he would not, bound with an oath to yield to his conditions, so that all hope is vain. Unless his noble mother and his wife, who, as I hear, mean to solicit him for mercy to his country. Therefore, let's hence, and with our fair entreaties, haste them on.
Whence are you?
Stand and go back.
You guard like men, 'tis well. But by your leave, I am an officer of state and come to speak with Cominius, Coriolanus.
From whence?
From Rome.
You may not pass, you must return. Our general will no more hear from thence.
You'll see your Rome embraced with fire before you speak to Coriolanus.
Good, my friends, if you have heard your general talk of Rome and of his friends there, it is lots to blanks. My name hath touched your ears. It is Menenius.
Be it so. The virtue of your name is not here passable.
I tell thee, fellow, the general is my lover. I have been the book of his good acts, whence men have read his name unparalleled. Therefore, I must have leave to pass.
Faith, sir, if you had told as many lies in his behalf as you have uttered in your own, you should not pass here. Though it were as virtuous to lie as to live chastely, therefore go back.
Prithee, fellow, remember my name is Menenius, always factionary on the party of your general.
Howsoever you have been his liar, as you say you have, I, for one, telling true under him, must say you cannot pass. Therefore, go back.
Has he dined, canst thou tell? For I would not speak to him till after dinner.
You are a Roman, are you?
I am, as thy general is.
Then you should hate Rome, as he does. Can you, when you have pushed out of your gates the very defender of them, and in a violent popular ignorance given your enemy your shield, think to front his revenges with the easy groans of old women as you seem to be? Can you think to blow out the intended fire your city is ready to flame in with such weak breath as this? No, you are deceived. Therefore, back to Rome and prepare for your execution. You are condemned. Our general has sworn you out of reprieve and pardon.
Fellow, if thy captain knew I were here, he would treat me with estimation.
My general cares not for you. Back, I say, go, lest I let forth your half-pint of blood. Back, that's the utmost of your having.
Nay,
back.
Nay, but fellow.
What's the matter?
Now, companion, you shall know now that I am in estimation. You shall perceive that a night watchman cannot office me from my son, Coriolanus. Oh, my son, the glorious gods sit in hourly synod upon thy particular prosperity. My son, thou art preparing fire for us. Look, here's water to quench it. I was hardly moved to come to thee, but being assured that none but myself could move thee, I have been blown out of our gates with sighs, and conjure thee to pardon Rome and thy petitionary countrymen. The good gods assuage thy wrath, and turn the dregs of it upon this varlet here, who like a block hath denied my access to thee.
Away.
Away!
Wife, mother, child, I know not.
My affairs are surrendered to others. Though I alone owe my revenge, my remission lies in Volscian breasts. That we have been familiar, ingrate forgetfulness shall poison rather than pity note how much. Therefore, be gone. Mine ears against your suits are stronger than your gates against my force. Yet for I love thee. Take this along. I read it for thy sake and would have rent it. Another word, Menenius, I will not hear thee speak. This man of Phidias was my beloved in Rome. Yet thou beholdst.
You keep a constant temper.
He is grown from man to dragon. This Martius has wings. He's more than a creeping thing. When he walks, he moves like an engine, and the ground shrinks before his treading. There is no more mercy in him than there is milk in a male tiger. He wants nothing of a god but heaven and an eternity to throne in.
Now, sir, is your name Menenius?
It is a spell, you see, of much power. You know the way home again.
You see how we are shent for keeping your greatness back.
Why do you think I have to swoon?
I neither care for the world nor your general. He that hath a will to die by himself fears it not from another. Let your general do his worst. I say to you as I was said to. Away.
A noble fellow, I warrant him.
The worthy one is our general. He's the rock, the oak, not to be windshaken.
We will before the walls of Rome tomorrow set down our host. My partner in this action, you must report to the Volscian lords how plainly I have borne this business.
Only their ends you have respected, stopped all ears against the general suits of Rome, and never admitted a private whisper. No, not with such friends that thought them sure of you.
This last old friend, whom with a cracked heart I sent home to Rome, loved me above the measure of a father, nay, guarded me indeed. Their latest refuse was to send him, for whose old love I have, though I showed sorrowly to him, once more offered up the first conditions, which they did refuse and cannot now accept, to grace him only the thought he could do more. A very little I have yielded to. Fresh embassies and suits nor from the state, nor private friends hereafter will I lend ear to. Ha! What shouts is this? Shall I be tempted to infringe on my vow at the same time 'tis made? I will not. My wife comes foremost, then the honored mold wherein this trunk was framed. But out, affection, all bond and privilege of nature break. Let it be virtuous to be obstinate. What is that curtsy worth? Or those dove's eyes which could make gods forsworn. I melt and am not made of stronger earth than others. My mother bows as if Olympus to a molehill should in supplication nod. Let the Volscians plow Rome and harrow Italy. I'll never be such a gosling to obey instinct and stand as if man were offered to himself and knew no other kin.
My lord and husband.
These are not the same eyes I wore in Rome.
The sorrow that delivers us thus changed makes you think so.
Like a dull actor now, I have forgot my part, and I am out, even to a full disgrace. best of my flesh. Forgive my tyranny, but do not ask for that. Forgive our Romans. A kiss. Long as my exile, sweet as my revenge. Now by the jealous queen of heaven, that kiss I carried from thee, dear, and my true lip hath virgined it ere since. You gods, I prate, and the noblest mother the world leave unsaluted. Sink my knee in the earth. Of thy deep duty, more impression show than that of common sons.
Oh, stand up, blessed. Whilst with no softer cushion than the flint, I kneel before thee, and unproperly show duty, as mistaken all this while between the child and the parent.
What is this? Your knees to me? To your corrected son? Oh, well, then let the pebbles on the hungry beach strike at the stars. Then let the mutinous winds fling the proud cedars against the fiery sun, murdering impossibility to make what cannot be slight work.
Thou art my warrior. I help to frame thee. This is a poor epitome of yours, which by the interpretation of full time may show like all yourself. Even your wife and I are suitors to you.
I beseech you, peace. Or if you'd ask, remember this before. The thing I have forsworn to grant may never be held by you denials. Do not bid me dismiss my soldiers. Do not tell me wherein I seem unnatural. Desire not to ally my rages and revenges with your colder reasons.
Oh, no more. No more. You have said that you would not grant us anything, for we have nothing else to ask but that which you deny already. Yet we will ask that if you fail in our request, the blame may hang upon your hardness. Therefore, hear us.
Aufidius, mark, we'll hear not from Rome in private. Your request?
Should we be silent and not speak? Our raiment and state of bodies would betray what life we have led since thy exile. Think how more unfortunate than all living women are we come hither, since that thy sight, which should make our eyes flow with joy, constrains them weep and shake with fear and sorrow, making thy mother, wife and child, to see our son, husband and father, tearing his country's bowels out. Alack, or we should lose the country, our dear nurse, or else thy person, our comfort in the country. For either thou must, as a foreign recreant, be led with manacles through the streets, or else triumphantly tread on thy country's ruin and bear the palm for having bravely shed thy wife and child's blood. I purpose not to wait on fortune till these wars determine. And if I cannot persuade thee rather to show a noble grace to both parts than seek the end of one, thou shalt no sooner march to assault thy country than tread upon thy mother's womb that brought thee to this world.
Aye, and mine that brought you forth our boy, to keep your name living to time.
Not of a woman's tenderness to be, requires nor child nor woman's face to see.
No, no, go not from us thus. If it were so that our request did tend to save the Romans, thereby destroy the Volscis whom you serve, you might condemn us as poisonous to your honor. Nay, our suit is that you reconcile them, and each and either side give the all hail to thee, crying, be blessed for making up this peace. Speak to me, son. Think'st thou it honorable for a noble man still to remember wrongs? Daughter, speak you. He cares not for your weeping. There's no man on earth more bound to his mother. And yet, here, he lets me prate like one in the stocks. Thou hast never showed thy dear mother any courtesy when she, poor hen, has clucked thee to the wars and safely home, loaded with honor. Say my request unjust, but if it be not so, thou art not honest, and the gods will plague thee. He speaks not, turns away. to his surname, Coriolanus, longs more pride than pity to our prayers. So, we will home to Rome and die among our neighbors. I am hushed until our city be afire. Then I shall speak a little.
Mother, mother, what have you done? Behold, the heavens do ope. The gods look down, and at this unnatural scene they laugh at. Mother, mother, oh, you have won a happy victory to Rome. But for your son, believe it, oh, believe it, most dangerously you have with him prevailed, if not most mortal to him. But let it come. Aufidius, though I cannot make true wars, I'll frame convenient peace. Now, good Aufidius, were you in my stead, would you have heard a motherless or granted less, Aufidius?
I was moved with awe.
I dare be sworn you were. And, sir, it is no little thing to make mine eyes sweat compassion. What peace you'll make, advise me. Oh, mother, wife, I'll not to Rome, but by and by, fear not, we will drink together. You deserve to have a temple built you. All the swords in Italy and her confederate arms could not have made this peace. Farewell. Farewell. What peace you'll make, Aufidius?
I must proceed, as do find the people, even in their ears and the common ones. I will avouch the truth of it. This traitor!
How?
I, traitor Martius! I, Martius, Caius Martius! Dost thou think I'll grace thee with that robbery? Thy stolen name, Coriolanus in Coriolis. Ha! Being banished, you did come onto my hearth, presented to my knife your throat. I took you, made you joint servants with me, gave in to all your own desires, let you choose from my files, your projects to accomplish, my best and freshest men, till at the end, oh, I seemed your follower, not partner, but here, to end where we were to begin, to take charge of our own action. This admits no excuse.
Hearest thou, Mars?
Name not the gods, thy boy of tears. Ha, no more.
Measureless liar! Thou hast made my heart too great for what contains it. Boy, oh slave! Cut me to pieces, Aufidius. Stain all your edges on me. Boy, oh false hound! If you have richer nails true, 'tis there, like an eagle and a dovecoat, I fluttered your false skins at Cariolis. Alone I did it, boy!
Oh, my rage is gone, and I am struck with sorrow. Let him die for it. I pawned my honor for his truth. You poor fools, whose children he hath unearthed. No, hold. Though in the city he hath on children and widowed. To the bewildered injury of this hour, he shall have a noble memory.